Hey everybody, I'm Ashley, and welcome to this month's edition of the Dollar Club, our opportunity to give just one extra dollar and see the amazing things that can happen when we all do good together. If you were with us last week, you know that Pastor Kevin invited all of us to come together to give to Proclamation Church.
We got an opportunity to receive our Dollar Club offering. We're going to tell you where it's going. We've never done that before. Proclamation Church is down in Antioch.
I was a part of the Summit Church in Raleigh-Durham, North Carolina. Big on missions, big on church planting. Being in that culture for so long, the Lord just really began to stir in our hearts that He's calling us somewhere else. You are sent somewhere else. And so we chose Nashville. About 60 of us moved from North Carolina, South Carolina, Georgia, Virginia to help start Proclamation Church.
Where have you seen God show up and be really faithful in your church?
Man, God has shown up and been faithful in the fact that, number one, we have this building, this church that we're sitting in right now. They were actually about to close their doors. They wanted the legacy of this building to continue on. They said, hey, we want to give you this building for free. We jumped in and we launched April of 2021.
Why did y'all pick this location and this neighborhood for the church?
Church plants come to Nashville all the time. This area of Nashville gets looked over by said church plants all the time. South Nashville is historically one of the most diverse areas of Nashville. We have a heavy Spanish-speaking population, Ethiopians, Kurds, Somalis, all throughout. And so we knew for sure that the Lord was calling us here to be this multi-ethnic, multi-generational church that speaks to the reconciling power of the gospel in a city that needed to see it. So in Nashville, as it will be in heaven, right? Heaven's gonna be family, heaven's gonna be diverse.
All of these people created in the image of God.
In the image of God. Yeah. Let's be about the Father's business now, right? And so we want to mirror what we see out in the neighborhood and the community. Another reason why we wanted to be in this specific area, the beginning of where we are, East Thompson and Murfreesboro, they call it Misery Mile. A lot of drugs, a lot of prostitution, just a lot of brokenness. And so for that reason, we say, man, we don't want to just be a church in the community. We want to be a church for the community. We want you to meet Jesus, but we want to meet you where you are while you're meeting Jesus and kind of see that flourishing take place as we're moving forward together.
What is the vision or dream that you have for this church?
We want to see this building used Sunday through Friday in strategic, specific ways. Our current kids space will turn into a shared office space where we're going to invite nonprofits to actually be here throughout the week so that they can do job training, budgeting, ESL classes. But then there's a whole nother portion of the building that really is not being utilized at all. We have a goal to turn all of that into kids space. We want to do affordable daycare for families as well. It's going to take time. It's going to take a lot of finances. Because we have plumbing issues, there's asbestos we just found out in it that we're going to have to like completely tear up, clean out. But our biggest need right now, we don't have space in our parking lot. We had 60 when we moved here. We're averaging about 250 now. We have some land on the backside of the building. It will increase our parking by like 30 spots. You hear that and it's like, that's not that much. You're right, it's not. And so it's like, okay, like in time, we're gonna be able to do this. But we also know if we want to be able to stay here, we're gonna have to really change this place up in such a way where we can be here, be committed.
Well, I know that we said we wanted to share your story and the story of Proclamation Church, but at CrossPoint, we also have this thing called the Dollar Club, where once a month we ask everybody in the church to throw in an extra dollar, pull all of that money together, find a need in the community that needs to be filled and go fill it. So we have a check for you, and I'm gonna read you the exact amount. $36,317.54.
You want to know what's dope?
Yeah.
That's why this is so crazy. We just got a quote for the parking lot. We were about $30,000 short to make sure that we were able to get it done.
Well, it's just God moving through the generosity of a whole lot of people.
And He provides. He steadily provides. Thank you. Thank you very much.
I love you, church. I love what we get to be part of. That's a picture of the kingdom of God. And we talked about last week how a mark of a New Testament church is generosity to other churches. We're not looking to build a brand, building a kingdom. And there are 2 million people in the metropolitan area, Nashville. If we're going to reach the whole city, it's going to take the whole church, like Big C Church. It's going to take all of the churches of the city coming together passionately in love with Jesus and loving this city toward Christ. Like, that's why we're here. That's what we exist for. So when I hear Pastor Delane talk, I'm just like, yes, that's it. We want to see up there come down here across the city. We want to see renewal in the church and revival in the city and awakening across Middle Tennessee. That's what we're praying for. And there can be a scarcity mentality because sometimes there can be a competition with other churches. And we just want you to know, like, we want no spirit of competition. Like, this is collaboration, us coming together. And a scarcity mentality could say, hey, you got to be careful mentioning other churches because there might be people who go to that church, who leave this church and go to that church. I want you to hear, if God's calling you, if you live around Proclamation Church, or if God's calling you to be a part of Proclamation Church, like, go. Like, go, like, don't hear what I'm not saying. Like, we love you here, and we want you here, and we want you to be a part of what's going on. But what we want most is that you would be where God has called you to be, somewhere you can roll up your sleeves and serve, somewhere that you can serve Jesus, somewhere where you serve others, somewhere you love people, somewhere you can give generously, somewhere that you can be a part of and grow in your faith and live out your faith. That's what we want. We want you to be where God has called you to be. And so if that's a cross point, be all in a cross point. And if that's a proclamation, be all in it, or wherever God has called you. It's going to take the whole church to reach the whole city with the whole gospel. And we want to be about that business. We want to be about that work. And I was just thinking about, like, this month of Awaken. In February, every year we take the month of February, and we invest in fasting and prayer for renewal in the church, revival in the city, and awakening across Middle Tennessee. And some people be like, well, why do you do that? Like, why do you do that in February? And the reason we are praying toward awakening in the city, and some people are like, well, especially like in Nashville. Nashville is like the buckle of the Bible Belt. Nashville is like one of the most religious places. It's a place where, I mean, you just see churches all over the place, a place where denominations frequently have their headquarters. Why would you do Awaken in Nashville? And I think it's because Nashville needs to wake up. Like, Christians, people who identify as Christians need to wake up, because you can fall asleep. Like, you can fall asleep physically. And some of you that, you know, maybe in the service, but you can fall asleep physically and you can fall asleep spiritually. Have you ever fallen asleep and not meant to? Have you ever been sitting on the couch watching TV, or maybe like in class, you know, and like you're just in class and you fall asleep and you didn't mean to, you didn't plan to, you didn't know you would. Sometimes we fall asleep and we don't even know that we're asleep until we wake up. Has that ever happened? Like, in that moment, you're like, drool's coming down. You're like, well, I guess I fell asleep. Like, in that moment, you realize, I just fell asleep. And you don't realize that until you wake up. Same is true spiritually. You can go through seasons of your life and be asleep spiritually and not know it until you wake up. And so we're praying for awakening because our city needs awakening. I saw some research that Barna Group did recently on the spirituality of our city. And here's what they found. They found that that 70% of our city identifies as Christian. So 70% of Nashville identifies as a Christian. It says, I'm a Christian. So what that means is that, let's say 7 out of 10 identify as Christian, 3 out of 10 would say I'm non-Christian, and that might be agnostic or atheist or maybe another religion, Muslim or Hindu, Buddhist, but they say I'm not a Christian. But I mean, 7 out of 10 would identify as Christians. Here's what's interesting about that, is that 3 out of those 7, so 3 out of 10, identify as active Christian or participating Christian, which the standard of that is attend church at least once a month. And we can have a conversation about that another time, but like 1 out of 4, so going to church once a month would say I am practicing Christian or I'm active in my faith, which means four out of seven who identify as Christians are non-active in their faith, or would identify and say, I am a non-participating Christian. What would you call a non-active, non-participating Christian? Asleep. Okay, so four out of seven, there are more asleep Christians than alive Christians. And so Paul writes this letter in the New Testament. He's like, and this is not just a now problem. It was a then problem. Paul writes this letter. He's like, wake up. The ink is not even dry on the scriptures yet. And he's saying, wake up in your faith. We can fall asleep spiritually. And so as a church, as the church, we're praying that Nashville would wake up. Can you imagine what would happen if 70% of this city was awake to the love of God? Can you imagine what would happen if 7 out of 10 people were filled with the Spirit of God? We're in on the move of God. We're all about loving people and serving people and sharing Jesus and living generously and actively growing in their faith. Can you imagine what would happen? Can you imagine the addicts who would be set free? Can you imagine the homeless of our city who would be loved and cared for? Can you imagine school administrators having trying to figure out how to reallocate their time because there are less disciplinary issues? Can you imagine how much fun it would be to teach school? Can you imagine how incredible it would be? I mean, just think about it with me. Like you just drive up in the parking lot at the grocery store and people are like, no, you can take this space. No, you can take this space. No, you can take this space. Can you imagine students not sitting alone in the lunchroom? Can you imagine what it would be like when somebody moves into your apartment and they're next door and they're just welcomed in? Can you imagine what it would be like if there were families waiting to foster children rather than kids waiting for foster homes? Can you imagine the marriages being restored? Can you imagine what it would be like to people openly praying with one another at work, sharing the gospel with others who have never heard? Can you imagine what it'd be like to walk down Broadway on a Friday night and hear How Great Is Our God coming from Tootsie's? Like, can you imagine? Can you imagine with me? And you're like, well, that can never happen. No, it has. It has happened in history. You can go through and read all of the great revivals and awakenings. It looked like that. Historically, it happened like that. And it began in the book of Acts. It began with the church adding 3,000 the very first day. The first day when the Holy Spirit comes upon the church, 3,000 people were saved and baptized in that one day. An explosive, you read through the book of Acts, and we've been reading through it together, seeing what this movement looked like. Man, how the Holy Spirit moves from the temple of God, presence of God, into the people of God. That's the first move. The second move is with the church, the center of the Jesus movement goes from Jerusalem to Antioch. We talked about that last week. Today, we're going to talk about this next move in the book of Acts, and you see it goes from Peter to Paul. It's the primary leader of the church, from Peter to Paul. Now, Paul didn't replace Peter. He just stood on his shoulders. And the movement continues through Paul. So we're going to look at Paul's life. We're going to talk about his story, but I want you to see this. Before God could make a move, first God had to make a leader. Before God makes a move, God makes a leader. And making a leader takes time. And this is true in the Bible, and this is true in life, in real life, because the Bible is real life. It takes time for a leader to form. And some of you are in leadership and positions right now, and you can look back and see it took a long time to grow, to develop. Some of you are being developed in obscurity right now. Don't forsake the process, because obscurity is where God does his finest work. But before God gives this position of leadership, he was forming Paul. Before he was known as Paul, he was known as Saul. Saul is his Hebrew name. He was a religious leader. He was the Pharisee of all Pharisees. I mean, he was a religious leader in that he gave his life to persecute Christians, followers of the way. He was devoted to extinguishing the movement of Jesus, jailed Christians. Even participated in their execution. The first martyrs of the church, Saul was involved in that. But then he encounters Jesus on the road to Damascus, has an encounter with Jesus, and Jesus calls him to take the gospel to the Gentiles, to the non-Jews. This is his story. Now, because of that, he takes the name Paul. Paul is, he was a Roman citizen, and he had the Latin name. He took the Latin name of Paul. Now, Paul, do you know what Paul means? This is the name he chose. Do you know what Paul means? Paul means small. So when it came time to choose a name, he chose short. It literally means short, short or humble. So he chose the name, and I'm like, out of all the names, bro, but the name that he chose, he just called me little man, right? I mean, so Paul, he chooses the name. He goes Saul, Hebrew name. Paul, he chooses that name to reach the Gentiles. Now, what's interesting about that, we don't have any pictures of him, but we do have a second century description of how he looked. I want you to see this with me. The Apostle Paul, a man small in size, bald-headed, bandy-legged, well-built, with eyebrows meeting, that's fallen, rather long-nosed, full of grace. For sometimes he seemed like a man, and sometimes he had the countenance of an angel. Whew. I love that. I love this so much. God's like, well, let's pick the short, bow-legged one with a big nose and a unibrow. Man looks at the unibrow, God looks at the heart. What can we take away from this? Is that God's not looking at the surface. God's not looking at the outside. That when God wants to form a leader, he's forming the heart. In a world that's all about style, God's looking for substance. In a world that's all about veneer, God's looking at the character. And God forms a Paul, but it takes time. He comes to Jesus when he's around 30, has this encounter with Christ. For the next 3 years, he's in Arabia, and he's in obscurity, and he's away from everybody else, and he's being discipled, he's being taught, he's been shaped, he's being formed by Christ. Before his public ministry, this is the process, what God does. And building a leader takes time. But I believe that God can do more with one person who is fully surrendered to him than he can with 99 people who are halfway. Paul was fully surrendered. It takes time. There's a book called The Green Letters by an author, Miles Stanford. He tells the story of a student who asked the president of his college if there was like a shortcut, if he could take a shorter course than the one that was prescribed. And listen to what the college president said. He said, yes, but it depends on what you want to be. He said, when God wants to make an oak tree, he takes 100 years. But when he wants to make a squash, he takes 6 months. You want to be an oak tree? Or do you want to be a squash? And he goes on to say that growth is not uniform, a uniform thing in the life of the tree or a Christian. In some single months, there is more growth than in all year. That's why a month like Awaken is so powerful. Month of prayer and fasting. Like, God can do more in a month than we can do in the rest of the year in our own strength, in our own power. It's powerful that God would grow, that God would work, that God would be working in obscurity to form and to shape a leader. And God was making small Paul into a mighty oak, a spiritual leader, his choice instrument to reach the Gentiles. But Paul wasn't perfect. He didn't have it all together. He never claims to. In fact, he's very open with the fact that sometimes he had no idea what he was doing. He didn't know where to go. Anybody else ever feel like that? You're like, I have no idea where I'm going. Anybody just want to admit it? Yeah, so right there with you. There are times where I'm like, man, I don't know where I'm going. Paul says this in Acts chapter 16. If you've been reading through, we've been reading one chapter a day, moving through. It's not too late to jump in, but in Acts chapter 16, Paul says, he's like, man, at one time, he says, I want to go to Asia. I want to go to Asia, but he says, but the Holy Spirit kept me from going there. And then he's like, I want to go to Bithynia. And he's like, but the Holy Spirit kept me from going there. And he's so exhausted of not knowing where to go that he lays down to take a nap. And when he has a nap, he sees a vision of a man from Macedonia that says, come to Macedonia. And we love that. We love the clarity and the vision and the specific of going to Macedonia. But we forget Paul is just as confused as we are. Like, he was just as confused as we were. He didn't know where to go, but God has a way of getting you where he wants you to be. But God cares more about who you are than where you are. He cares more about who you are on the inside than where you are on the planet. And God will get you, Paul's proof, God will get you where he wants you. But he's more focused on the person that we're becoming than the place we are. And God gets Paul to Macedonia. And there he comes to a city called Philippi. This is chapter 16. And one thing I found so interesting about the reading this week, and if you read through, you noticed it too. There are two miraculous stories of people being set free from prison. You've got one involving Peter and one involving Paul, and they're both set free. So in our reading this week, within a span of a couple chapters, you've got Peter who's set free from prison and Paul who's set free from prison. And I realize, ladies who are watching it, God behind bars, and men who are on the Pando app, I want you to know there are more ways for us to be locked up in life than being in prison. There are people who are in the seats at all of our campuses. All of us at some time or another can be locked up in here. And God gives us these stories, these historical stories that actually happened physically. And one of the reasons he gives them to us is to teach us spiritually how he still sets people free. Because we can be locked up in fear. Some who are locked up in anxiety or locked up in guilt or locked up in shame or imprisoned by addiction. It's possible to be locked up for things that happened in the past or trapped by bitterness or unforgiveness. I know there have been times and moments in my life where I've been locked up in fear and in the what ifs and in the not knowing what's coming up next. I mean, there have been nights where I've been awake and I haven't been able to sleep. And the reason I haven't been able to sleep is not because of something that I ate, but it's what's eating me. And I've been up at midnight. Anybody else ever been up at midnight? I've never not been able to sleep because the tape keeps playing over and over and over and over again. The betrayal or the hurt or the pain or maybe something that other people have done or maybe something that you've done and because of that overplay through, or maybe just about the future and the circumstances that you can't control. And midnight is the time where it's furthest from the evening and it's furthest from the morning, and it's in midnight that things are real silent and they're real quiet, but at the same time, man, the voices can be real loud. And what do you do at midnight when you're locked up? What do you do at midnight when it's the darkest and it's silent around, but it's loud in here? That's what we're going to talk about today. And I want to take us there from these two stories. There's one that's found in Acts chapter 11. The other one's found in Acts chapter 16. And the first one, we'll just kind of tell you, then the second one, I don't know what the third one is, but the second one we'll look at together. So Acts chapter 11 tells the story of Peter. And Peter was placed in prison by Herod. And Herod, they killed James, the first apostolic martyr in the church. He ran James through with a sword. And so Herod, for the approval of the people, Herod said he was going to take Peter down next. And Peter was the lead in the church. And so he takes Peter and puts him in prison and said that his trial would be coming soon. And the church is earnestly praying. So Peter is locked up. He's in prison. He's between two guards. And the church, it says that they were earnestly praying in the house, in the upper room. They're praying for him to be set free, praying for the Lord to intervene. And that night, as they're praying, an angel comes to Peter, tells him, says, get on your sandals, get on your clothes, the chains fall off, and the angel escorts him out of the prison. Now imagine being Peter. And I love that he's asleep. Like, you know that's the peace of God, when the trial's coming the next day and Peter's sleeping. But then he wakes up. He just follows. And it says, like, when he's outside, he's like trying to figure out what just happened. And he goes to the house where they're having the prayer meeting. Now they're having the prayer meeting and they're in there praying. They got their holy huddle, you know, they're around their holding hands and they're praying. And then her name was Rhoda, young teenage girl. She goes to the door because she hears the door knock. And Peter's outside the door. She opens up the door. She looks outside. She shuts it. She's like, it's Peter. She runs inside and she goes and tells the group that's praying. She's like, Peter's here. They're like, you're crazy. They're like, Peter's not here. There's no way that Peter's here. Peter's in jail. They're praying that he'd be released. And so Rhoda, she goes back. She's like, I'm not crazy. She goes to the door and there's Peter. Like Peter's just standing there. Can you imagine being, like you're so excited to be out of prison. You're knocking on the door. They open the door, they close it. You're like, what was that? And they open up the door and he gets going. And Peter gets to interrupt the prayer meeting where they're praying for his release. What do we learn from this? Here's what you see. Freedom comes through earnest prayer of the church. Through earnest prayer of the church, through other believers praying for you. It is powerful. Don't minimize the power of prayer. They are interceding for him. And in that prayer, God does the thing that there is no way that they could have set Peter free. They didn't have the power to do that. They didn't have the resources to do that. They were desperate for God, and God moved in that way. It takes faith to pray. You know what else? It takes faith to ask for prayer. Some of us, man, we try to solve it in our own strength and in our own power. We have to come to terms with our own powerlessness and ask other people, hey, will you pray for me? It's an act of faith. It takes an act of faith to open the door and to let Peter in. I think for some of us, man, we've been praying for revival and it's happening. It's happening outside the door. It's happening. It takes faith. Some of us have been praying for revival in our own families, in our own neighborhood. It takes faith to actually open the door and say, yes, it's happening. Because sometimes there's fear of like, well, what if it's not real? What if it's not really happening? It takes faith to open up and say, come on in. For some of us, the thing that we're praying for is right there in front of us, but it takes faith to welcome it in. And we believe in the power of prayer. It's why at the end of every service at all of our campuses, we have a team up front who would love to pray with you. It's why we have the first Sunday of every month, we have prayer at all of our campuses to help pray for you, to intercede, to pray with others. It's why every Tuesday for the past 7 years, we have gathered for prayer at 11 o'clock at our Nashville campus. Because we believe in the power of prayer. Here's what I believe. I believe God can do more in an hour of prayer than we can do in a decade of striving in our own strength and our own power. You believe that with me? Like that we would step in and we say, God, I believe you can do more than I can do. And Jesus said, if you remain in me and I in you, you'll bear much fruit. But apart from me, you can do nothing. He said, and prayer is that place where we abide and we put our dependence on God. So freedom comes through prayer. Through the prayer of others. And then we also see from this story in the second story in Acts chapter 16, we see Paul and Silas, they end up in Macedonia. They end up in Philippi. So when Paul writes the letter to the church at Philippi, he's writing to the place that he visited here, the book of Philippians. And Paul shows up in that town. And when they get there, now remember, this is a Roman city. This is a place where there were many different gods, but they had never heard the name of Jesus. So when Paul gets there, they encounter this young girl who is who's a slave, and she is being held by her boss in that she would, through demonic spirits, she was a fortune teller. And so they were making all kind of money off of her suffering. And so Paul and Silas, his traveling companion, they meet her and they pray for her and she's delivered. She's delivered from these demonic spirits. And so now, which is really bad for business. Jesus was really bad for their business. And so these she's now free and in her right mind. And now her owners, they're ticked off because he's messing with her wallet. And so they end up stirring up this riot. And so other people are like, hey, we got to do something with them. And so they take them before the magistrate, and they end up being falsely accused, beaten, and imprisoned for preaching the gospel and for doing the works of the ministry. And in verse 23, it tells us, after they had been severely flogged, they were thrown into prison, and the jailer was commanded to guard them carefully. And when he received these orders, he put them in the inner cell and fastened their feet in the stocks. So there is Paul and Silas who have been flogged, and flogging is it's a horrific form of torture that the Romans perfected, in that they'd take a long strand of leather cords and they would attach bone and glass to rip the flesh off of someone's back to the point of just short of death. So Paul and Silas suffer that publicly. And then they're taken into prison and they're placed in stocks in the inner cell, surrounded by other prisoners. And as they're there with their feet, and I want you to think about that. They've experienced unjust suffering at the hands of evil people. stuck in circumstances that they can't get out of. In verse 25, it says, about midnight. About what? Midnight. At the darkest hour. When things were the darkest, when they couldn't see, when it was quiet, when the what ifs start playing, when they're going back and watching the tape in their mind over and over and over again about what happened to them, when fear and anxiety begin to rush in, about midnight, what did Paul and Silas do at midnight? Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the other prisoners were listening to them. Here's what they did. They sang in the dark. When it's about midnight, that's what you do. You sing in the dark. And they begin to sing, and they begin to pray, and they begin to praise. And because they messed around, they put a Paul with a Silas. And Paul and Silas, they knew what to do in these moments. They begin to sing, and they begin to pray, and they begin to praise. And when they did, other people began to listen. They gained an audience with the other prisoners. They're leaning in because they're like, who sings at midnight? Who sings with their feet in stocks? Who sings when they've been flogged? Who sings when they've suffered? Who sings at that moment? A Paul and a Silas do, and they begin to sing, and they begin to gain an audience, but that wasn't their audience. Their audience was one. Their audience was one who was worthy and one who was with them, and in that moment when they began to sing and when they began to pray and they began to praise, they began to sing to God, I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. Who sings about the goodness of God when they're in an inner cell? Those who know it. Those who declare it, those who experience it in that moment. When things are the darkest, your worship is your weapon. They begin to sing, and what happens in that moment? Well, the thing that they couldn't do. Suddenly, there was such a violent earthquake that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and all at once, the prison doors flew open, and everyone's chains came loose, and the jailer woke up, and when he saw the prison doors open, he drew his sword and was about to kill himself because he thought the prisoners had escaped. But Paul shouted, don't harm yourself. We're all here. The Lord moves, and things move. The ground shakes. There's an earthquake. The prison doors open. How much influence did the Apostle Paul have in that, like, the doors open up, everybody's chains fall off? He's like, hey, y'all don't go anywhere. Like, y'all just stay. How much influence did he have that nobody left? Everybody sat there together. And the jailer thinks it's the end because under Roman law, his life would be required if any prisoners were to escape. And in that moment, he comes in. Paul's like, hey, we're not going anywhere. We're right here with you. Think about this. Peter was delivered from his prison so that he could go on and preach the gospel. Paul stayed in his so that he could preach the gospel too. See, your freedom is not just for you, it's for others. If God has set you free, and free indeed, your freedom is so that you can help bring freedom to other people. So Paul, in the place that he's in, he stays behind. In verse 29, it says, the jailer called for the lights, rushed in and fell trembling before Paul and Silas. And then he brought them out and asked them, sirs, what must I do to be saved? And they replied, believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved, you and your household. Then they spoke the word of the Lord to him and all the others in the house. And at that hour of the night, the jailer took them and washed their wounds. And then immediately he and all his household were baptized. And the jailer brought them into his house and set them a meal before him. And he was filled with joy because he had come to believe in God. He and his whole household. Paul and Silas, they show us what to do at midnight. What do you do at midnight? You worship. What do you do at midnight? You pray. What do you do at midnight? You praise, because when we draw near to him, he draws near to us. When we praise him, we experience his presence and his power and his glory. When we cry out to him, God does the things for us that we can't do on our own. He brings freedom to our hearts, and that freedom comes through a sacrifice of praise. Why do we call it a sacrifice of praise? Because when you're in prison, when you're locked up, we don't feel like praising. It's a sacrifice to do the thing that you don't want to do. See, a lot of us, we know how to praise on the mountaintop. We know how to praise after a promotion. We know how to praise when we're healthy and when the kids are well, and when things are going good. We know how to praise them on the mountain. But do you know what to do in the valley? Because the enemy doesn't know what to do with a valley worshiper. The enemy doesn't, the world doesn't know what to do. Other people who are locked up don't know what to do with somebody who worships in the valley, in the midnight when it's the darkest hour, and cries out and worships. But what we found is they found freedom too. There are other people who their freedom will come from your worship. Other people, the chains that will come off in their life because you declare what is true. It takes faith to worship at midnight, to sing. But when you sing at midnight, hey, your worship is a weapon. When you sing at midnight, your song is your strength. When things are the darkest and we sing, and it drives back darkness with our worship. You've experienced that the light rushes in. Experience the peace and the presence and the power of God. Chains break. People set free. The glory comes. That jailer asked the question, what must I do to be saved? Paul knew what his freedom was for. It was to help this jailer find freedom too. He was about to take his own life. Maybe you've been at the lowest of lows. And what God wants you to know is what this jailer found out is that there was purpose in living, and that there is freedom in Christ, that in Jesus, your past can be forgiven. He forgives you past, present, and future for all of your sin. New life. If anyone's in Christ, they're a new creation. The old is gone, the new is come. That God has a dream and a purpose and a plan for you. And that jailer gave his life. Jailer who was more locked up than even some of the other prisoners, that jailer gave his life to Christ, and he and his whole household, his family, were all saved and baptized. There is influence. You have influence. When you make a decision for Christ, it affects other people. His whole family has changed. And when we have the book that was written to the church at Philippi, to the Philippians, guess who was sitting in that group? That jailer who made that decision for Christ, to trust him, to believe. Where did Paul learn to praise? Where did Silas learn to pray at midnight? Where did Peter and the church learn to pray when it was darkest? They didn't learn it in the Instagram ad. They learned it from Jesus. Because the night before he was betrayed, before he went to the cross in the upper room, he prayed with his disciples. He knew what was coming. Prayed with his disciples. When they left that room and they walked down the stairs and he was going to the garden to pray and he was going to walking toward his betrayal that would ultimately lead to the cross. Matthew tells us that they sang a hymn. Jesus and the disciples. That he's singing a hymn at midnight. At the darkest time, Jesus taught them how to sing. He taught them how to sing in the dark. Go back and look at what song would they have sung around the Passover time. They would have sung Psalm 118, which says that the cornerstone that the builders rejected, talking about Jesus' prophetic psalm, so that passage is in there. But then it also says, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Jesus walking with the disciples saying, this is the day. At midnight, this is the day that the Lord has made. Knowing that he would go to the cross for our forgiveness so that we could be set free. Jesus sang at midnight so that you can sing at midnight. So that sin and death and hell does not have a grip on you. So that you'd be set free. in the darkest hour, in a hospital room, in a living room, an unemployment line, so that you can sing at midnight. Maybe for you, it's like the jailer. The question is, what must I do to be saved? Like, what do I have to do to experience this? Well, I want to lead you in a prayer in a moment. If you want to begin that relationship with Jesus, if you want to know forgiveness and begin to walk with him, I want to lead you in a prayer. But then I want to invite all of us to be practicing Christians. That it would be 7 out of 7 in this room. That we will sing. And the midnight you may be in, it may be in the middle of the night, you may be of your soul, it might be there is suffering that you can't solve or a situation that you can't change, you can't fix, an issue in your family that you don't know how to deal with, or maybe there's sickness that you're struggling with, maybe a financial problem, or maybe there are legal issues or a work situation, or perhaps you've experienced injustice and you've experienced betrayal and you've experienced hurt and pain and you're like, I need freedom. We experience freedom when we offer a sacrifice of praise. And so I want to invite you. We're going to sing together. But first, let's pray. God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for your truth. We thank you for these stories that actually happen. God, I thank you that they're still happening. And so I pray for those today that need to know that they have eternal life in you, that need to receive the forgiveness that only Jesus can bring. And if that's you, if you've never put your trust in Christ, then I want to invite you to make it your prayer. You can pray something like this. You can just whisper it after me. Father, thank you for loving me. Thank you for sending Jesus for me. Right now, I give my life to you. I ask you to forgive me of my sin. Give me your righteousness. I'm going to begin to live life with you and live life for you. Thank you for saving me. Father, thank you for those decisions that were made. I pray that just like the one we read about, that you would give the boldness and the courage to make faith public. And I pray for households to be changed. For households to be changed. God, that you'd wake us up. So even now, as we sing and as we declare what's truth with our mouths, God, I pray that light would rush in. That there would be freedom and peace and joy in our hearts. And that we would press back the darkness with our song. In Jesus' name we pray. In Jesus' name we praise. Amen. Will you stand with me, church?